Well, good evening once again. For those of you who may not know me, I see a few new faces. My name is Barakiel, and this is Shamini, and we are very happy to be here with all of you in our Gita Satsang. And today, because some of you may know it's Valentine's Day, I don't think it's very much celebrated here in India, but nevertheless, we thought it would be a good opportunity for us to talk about a topic that is, in a way, in my opinion, hard to talk about, and it is, in some ways, also misunderstood, you could say, or misrepresented. It is a topic, of course, of divine love. And it's fun for me in some ways, because it is a growth that we all go through, how to expand ourselves, how to love ever more deeply, ever more freely, without attachment, without wanting anything in return. And many of you know that I used to live in a monastery for a long time, for 6 years or so. And let's face it, before I got married to Shamini, I actually never had any relationship or loving relationship like that with anybody else. And, you know, living in the monastery teaches you many wonderful things. And, you know, it made me who I am and is wonderful. But when you start being in a marriage, and I mean this in a very good way, you start to discover things in yourself that you didn't really realize they were there. For example, I always consider myself to be very loving and very patient. And I still think I'm loving and patient, and I hope so. But I discovered I'm not as much as I thought I was, which I think is something we all start discovering. You know, when you are with other men, you are not, even if you are living together. See, especially men are much more impersonal, they are much more detached. And even if something happens, you know, nothing, you know. You go to your room, they go to the room, like nothing has happened at all. But, you know, when you had to live with somebody all of your life, and, you know, day in and day out, you start seeing many, many more things, and then the test, you know, can start coming, and then you can start also developing in some ways. It's not that one way is better than the other, but in some ways you become aware of it faster. And if you are a yogi, it's a good thing, because then you can work with it, and then you can work with yourself, not with the other person. I mean, of course, also, but you start working with yourself on how, why am I feeling this way? How is my love imperfect? And in a way, it's illogical to think that we'll ever perfect it until, of course, we find freedom. But nevertheless, it's our duty to more and more do that. In fact, as I was thinking about this, the only thing that came close to me, the closest thing that I had to this is that I used to like and having cats. And the cats, you know, they were always with me, and, you know, I love them very much. But, you know, if I had a cat, I could say, well, I'm going for the weekend. If you finish your food, you can go out and hunt if you want, and, you know, get your own food or whatever like that. But certainly that, of course, doesn't work in a marriage. And you should never want it that way. And, you know, this subject of divine love is something very important for all of us, and something that we had to realize that it is something we want to develop, the heart's love. Now, the heart's love, when we start developing it, of course, you know, we tend to get hurt. It's a little bit, in a way, trial and error. At the beginning, we start opening ourselves, and we open ourselves in the wrong way, and, oh, we get hurt. Somebody does something we were not expecting, and then we suffer, because our love was conditioned. You know, we were expecting people to act in a certain way. The moment they stop acting in that way, we feel hurt. And this happens with everybody. With everybody, with Guru Bhais, which is a great relationship we have. Friends, some master call it the greatest of all relationships, is friendship. Still the same way. And in a way also, Yogananda used to say, the closest that comes to divine love is a mother's love. Mother's love, the first child, not the first child, but with a newborn, that unconditional love that comes to the mother especially, and that they can do anything for the child, even give their lives willingly if they want. But even then, even that such a divine kind of love still is not perfect. Because, let's face it, nobody feels the same kind of love for somebody else's newborn than for your own newborn. And in that, it tells you already that you are loving him or her so much because he's yours. So even in that, there is that little bit of ego that is on the way. And who can we turn on for the turn towards for this kind of divine love? Obviously, and as we always say, it is the saints. And we have chosen a sloka in the Gita, which in a way I think no matter which sloka you choose from the Gita, it is all about divine love, because it's God talking to the devotee, how can you go back to him? So in a way, I think they all represent love, and I think we could have chosen any of them and talked about the same topic. So in a way, it may not matter much what we talk about, what we read here. So it's 12, 10, and 11. If, however, you find yoga practice too difficult, then perform all actions in the thought of me. By this means, too, you shall achieve final success. But if even during activity you cannot think of me, then give me your intentions. Ever striving to discipline your mind, offer to me the fruits of every labor. These are some slokas that, you know, before this Krishna was talking, you know, offer everything to me. If you cannot do that, at least do this and do this and do this. And he goes to the ever more like more merciful towards the devotee. Okay, if you cannot do this and at least that, until in one of the translations that Swamiji quotes, he says, even if you cannot give me the fruits of your labors, give me your failures, even that I will take. And we talk about that many times here, but just let's think it in the other way. The amount of divine love that God will have towards humanity, towards the devotee, to say that even that is good, even do that and you can still move towards me. Even if you fail, if you give me your failure, that is good. I will love you. Another very common sloka of the Gita that we always remember, that Krishna says that when virtue declines and vice is in the ascent, I incarnate myself as an avatar. And we don't realize, we always know, yes, the avatar is coming, you know, we are very happy. But we don't realize that in itself is the ultimate act of divine love. That out of pure, what is an avatar? Is a soul, you can say, that is one with the infinite, that has no desires, has no karma at all. He is, you know, it's very hard to visualize because even whatever we visualize is limited, but imagine he's merged one with the infinite and has no compulsion, nothing to come back to this earth. Still, they have the desireless desire to help all of us. That they don't come here with any karma of their own, they only come to help us. Now, that is kind of divine love. As Swamiji says in his Festival of Light, no greater love can be than this. And then, you know, we think about our day-to-day life. How can we express this in our lives? I wanted this topic is a good excuse for me to bring up this book, which I love very much and I really recommend. And I wanted to read a couple things from this book. Life is the divine impetus of love. The force behind the universe is love. And from that love is bred all desire and all creativity. Some desire causes delusion, but not all. When love is rightly directed, it awakens divine devotion and an eagerness to find new and ever higher ways of serving the Supreme Being. Now, Swami has said many times that love, divine love, is, he described it as bliss in motion, that out of that consciousness of bliss came the divine love through Om, through the Divine Mother. And that's why it's saying that also is the force behind the universe. But also, when you look at this, you will see that we are all very capable and very good at loving. Because it says here, some desires, an aspect of love causes desires, which is also in the form of delusions. And I think we all are experts at creating that kind of love for this world, that, you know, it makes us more and more enmeshed. But not all. When it is rightly directed, it creates that devotion that it is very much needed for us to succeed in the spiritual path. And the thing is that talking about love, I honestly believe it's a really high bar. There is very few people, or I don't think anybody except the saints, can perfectly express this love that is without attachment, that is without expecting anything in return, that is just pure giving. But, in some ways, I think it's a little tough for us to think in that way of just love, of giving, which in a way is also giving of our own joy. That's a very important aspect of it. But we all can think on this other way, on this lower aspect of love, you can say, which is kindness. That is something that all of us can do. That wherever you go, whoever you meet, use kindness, be kind, express kindness in everything. When you go to the shopkeeper, you know, instead of going and saying, I know you're going to cheat me, I'm not going to pay this much instead. Just make friends with people. Just have that loving attitude towards everybody. And you will see that you will find not only happiness, but love in return to you. The secret of love is to give love. And in that way, you will receive love back. Or even if you don't receive it from people, you will receive it from God, which is even better. That I know that whenever I go to a shop or I get stopped by the police, which happens very, very little, it happened recently, that's why I'm saying it. I always go with that attitude of, you know, just having fun with them, but not in a bad way, in just enjoying with them the situation or whatever it may be. You know, the shopkeepers as well, you know, asking discounts, you know, by laughing with them and being friendly towards them. And I probably think they still cheat me, but it doesn't matter because in the process, he's happier, I'm happier, and very often they start taking selfies with me, which, whatever. And that brings you happiness, that brings you fulfillment, and that is a stepping stone for us to learn to express this love, to learn to give our joy and to give of ourselves in every moment. Now, I want to conclude, before I take too much time, by a final reading from this book. And I want you to pay attention to what he says here. All action is the material result of thought. Suffering is the result of thinking into pain. Disease is the result of thinking into weakness. Every emotion is the result of right or wrong thinking, with one exception, love. Selfless love is not an emotion, but a principle. As the generator of life, love pervades all things and is in all things. Thought working within this principle creates things of beauty and perfection. Thought working outside this principle creates misunderstanding and ruin. There is no other secret of life.
Good evening, everybody. And it is, this was actually, today was so funny for us because it was one of the hardest days to choose a reading from the Gita. We just knew, let's talk about divine love. It's an opportunity to tune into that. Since the whole world is thinking of love, why don't we think of divine love and all of us come together? But like Bara was saying, every shloka in the Gita somehow comes back to bhakti, comes back to that divine love. But, you know, in this one, I was just thinking about, you know, on the equation of the love connection with the guru, the way the guru works with us. And this shloka especially, what Bara read and the whole part of it, which many of you must know, in a way summarizes our whole path, the way Master worked with us, where he told us, just do 1% of what I've given you and you will get there. And that's what Krishna is saying in a way here. He tells him, absorb your consciousness in me and then you'll get there. If you can't do that, then practice the path of yoga and you'll get there. If you can't do that, then, so he just keeps giving him options. And that's so sweet, isn't it? Like a parent with the child. And then he says, if you can't practice yoga, then think of me in every action that you do. At least do that much and offer the action. If you can't think of me in every action, then just place your, put your intention. And that was the end of it. Put your intention into every action that you're offering me the fruits of your labor. And in a way, what Swamiji says here is, our intention is everything. So what is our intention that we're setting? So on this and on what Bara was sharing on the topic of divine love, which in a sense, like we're saying, comes in every aspect of the Gita, every aspect of our path, and it's the main point of the spiritual path. If we don't offer our devotion, we won't make it, we won't move forward, isn't it? And so maybe just a practical suggestion for us this week, maybe all of us can ask this question, you know, when we wake up in the morning, just ask, what is my intention for today, for this day? Every day is a new opportunity for us, a new gift that we are getting to try harder to work with ourselves. It's just a simple question. How can I make this the best day of my life? How can I put everything in? And in that question can come, how can I serve everyone who comes to me? Or how can I expand, use this opportunity that's coming as an opportunity to expand my heart's love into this situation? And of course, most of us must be doing this as meditators on this path. But, you know, consciously just asking this question, because we can go into this with such in the smallest of things which add up. So, for example, we wake up and the first thing we do is we meditate. We practice, or perhaps some of you, we read the Gita. Some people do that. Or they chant, or whatever may be, you practice an affirmation. In that moment, we're just absorbing ourselves in this divine love, trying to come into that vibration of love, isn't it? We're trying to come into the vibration of the Guru. And once we leave our meditation, when we try to bring that presence into our work or into our service or into our interaction with our family or anything that we have, again, it's a beautiful opportunity to go into the little specifics. So, for example, if you go for a walk after your meditation, and that's a wonderful opportunity in nature. God is easily accessible in nature, visible to us. Trying to see the divine, to see Divine Mother in the beauty around us. Or if we go to work and the colleague gives a wonderful solution to a problem, try to see Divine Mother's intelligence behind that person, isn't it? Or if we see a kind act from someone similarly, if in laughter with a friend, try to feel that humor of Divine Mother laughing with us in that situation. So she becomes alive in the smallest of aspects. And in that, over time, it becomes our bigger intention for life. Maybe it starts with, I just want to feel you every moment. I just want to try to bring you more today into every aspect of my life than I did yesterday. And then all of a sudden, it becomes more and more our reality. We're vibrating in that reality. And I was recently listening to this satsang of Swamiji in his later years. And very sweet, he was telling us, you know, the story of when he was a young boy in college, and he used to be intellectual. He really wanted to know things and figure out, and he was just always in a lot of doubt, he tells us, that he wanted to know the truth. Why am I here? What is the purpose? And he was even asking, if there's a God, what must he be? And so he was one day, he was telling us, he was just sitting over there, you know, in the corner, and his college mates came home and saw him there, and they kind of said to each other, why is he always so serious? And he said, but I was serious, he tells. You know, he's like, I wanted to know, what is this? And the sweet thing that he said, that it was only after he found Master that he found himself laughing all the time. And he said, this path is so beautiful because it gives us a chance to open our hearts. And if we think about it, coming back to even what Bara was sharing, just the opportunity to open our hearts more and more. Every technique that we have is a chance for us to put more of our heart's love, to put more of that heart's energy out, put it into our kriya technique, into our meditation, into chanting, affirmation, interaction, satsang, whatever that you may pick up, 1% of it, and we have an opportunity to put more of our heart's love. And the more and more we do that, the more we start putting ourselves in that vibration of love. And it is from that point that we're able to attract the Divine Mother's love, the Divine Mother's energy into our lives. And so let's try this. Let's try to keep this intention for this week with us. How can I love you more? How can I feel you more with me? And just ask this question, how can I make of today the best day that I can? And in that, as we did the chant, that's when Yoganandaji would say, if you shut me out, how can I come in? And so in that opening of our hearts, that intention to have the Guru with us, he can come, he can steal into our hearts, he can banish us from all this delusion that is, and just put us in this vibration of love.